Bob Herbert's op-ed.tv is made possible in part by the CUNY TV Foundation with the support of Ann Ulnick.
Hi, I'm Bob Herbert. Welcome to op-ed.tv. As we emerge, hopefully, from this COVID-19 pandemic, we are headed straight toward a housing crisis in New York. At some point, the moratoriums on evictions and foreclosures will be lifted, and an awful lot of New Yorkers will not have the money to pay their back rent or their mortgage arrears. What will this mean, not just for tenants, homeowners, and landlords, but for New Yorkers at large? We'll talk about all of this with my guest, Dr. Samuel Stein, a housing policy analyst at the Community Service Society and the co-author of a report on the looming mortgage crisis facing New York. Dr. Stein, thanks so much for being with us. I appreciate it.
Thanks for having me, Bob.
So let's start with what's happening right now. What are the protections that are currently in place against evictions and foreclosures?
Yeah, so right now we have a kind of multiple patchwork of eviction and foreclosure prevention. At the federal level, the CDC has said it's not good for the general public health for people to be thrown out of their homes, and so has created systems for people to basically attest that they can't pay due to COVID and the recession and get protection that way. At the more local level, New York State passed a total limitation on foreclosures and evictions that is about to expire and move into a system where tenants have to sign a form that declares that they had a hardship. And if they sign that form, then their case doesn't proceed. Now, that doesn't do anything about the money that they owe, but it does at least keep people from being evicted until May 1st.
So does that mean that in New York State, no one is being evicted and no homes are being foreclosed on?
Well, there's a couple exceptions.
I was afraid of that.
Yeah. So first of all, there's informal or illegal evictions. So people being locked out of their apartments and maybe they didn't have a lease on it in the first place, or the landlord is hoping that they won't get caught. So we do have that kind of underground informal eviction happening. The other thing that can happen is landlords can still go forward with evictions if the tenant is a danger to their neighbors, for example, is harassing people in the building. So that kind of thing isn't protected. But otherwise, if you can say that you have a hardship because of COVID, which basically everybody who can't pay rent or their mortgage has, then you should be good till May 1st. You just have to sign that form.
So like so much else in this pandemic, it's a complicated situation. So how do you expect these moratoriums to be lifted? For example, is it going to be in phases, or do we expect something from the federal government and then the state or vice versa? Do you have a sense of that?
I think it's still up in the air, and it's a political question. It could be that the federal government resolves this in a clear way, that they extend an eviction moratorium that's more expansive than the one under the Trump administration. It could be that they supply enough funding to pay back all that rent arrears, all that owed money, and we can move forward. But it's also possible that they won't, and that the state will have to intervene in one way or another, and that the city will also have to figure out how it's going to handle its side of this question. So, you know, in our federalist system where each side has a piece, it's also possible for nobody to take control and for a lot of people to fall through the cracks.
When we do begin to lift these moratoriums, that will happen at some point, do you expect a lot of chaos and extreme hardship? The reason I'm asking is, a lot of people have not paid their rent for most of the period of the pandemic, or pay their mortgages, for example. And, you know, most of us remember what happened in the aftermath of the housing crisis in 2008 and 2009. From your studies of the situation, do you have any sense of what to expect?
Yeah, well, first let's talk about the scale of unpaid rent right now. So in New York State, the best estimates are over $2 billion.
$2 billion
with a B. It's a lot of money. That's just in New York State. And so we're going to see if there's no major intervention and those eviction moratoria are drawn back, a lot of tenants very vulnerable to eviction, and a lot of homeowners vulnerable to foreclosure, and of course, a lot of landlords also. And I think that's a really interesting question. Even if we're thinking on behalf of the tenant, what happens when the landlord isn't paying their mortgage, and what are the sort of causes of that that are older than the pandemic?
That was going to be my next question. If people are not, speaking about tenants now, if people are not paying their rent, landlords have to, you know, by definition, landlords are going to be hurt. Now we have some giant corporations who are landlords and have massive amounts of apartments and homes and that sort of thing. But we also have a lot of smaller operations. Is there any kind of protection for them, or do we expect a lot of people to go under?
So once again, there's a bit of a patchwork. So we have these foreclosure programs right now that exist, but as we saw in 2008, it really isn't enough. We've also seen since 2008, a major consolidation of ownership in New York City, in New York State, but across the country as well. So now a private equity firm like Blackstone is the world's largest private landlord.
Wow.
We still have small operators, but they probably are, you know, maybe 20% of the housing stock. And a lot of them are looking to sell. And then there is in between, you know, the poles of the Blackstones on the one side and the single family homeowner with a one tenant on the other, a large middle. And that large middle was able to benefit over the last couple decades from the gentrification of New York City. And also from a credit market that rewarded them for taking out equity from their buildings.
Right. So, you're touching on one of the most important parts of the report that I mentioned in the introduction. So we've seen, especially if you live here in New York City, we've seen the cycles of boom and bust in the real estate industry, and at times they've been really extreme. And so if you could try to explain how and why that cycle plays out and who benefits from it and who gets hurt.
Yeah, that cycle has repeated itself many times throughout history. And often if you think about the big crashes that we've seen in our local and national economy, they're often preceded by real estate bonanzas.
Right.
So the cycle is usually kind of boom, extravaganza, bust, and then recovery. And so it's like a long arc that flows in that direction. And it's caused by the ability of private landowners and private building owners to derive more and more profit from their buildings until tenants can't pay anymore, which can then induce that bust until the right. buildings are overvalued far beyond the means that anybody can. And I think that that's directly a reflection of the fact that private owners historically can raise rents far more than folks' wages are going up. So we've seen the rise in rents almost completely decoupled from a rise in wage for the bottom half of workers. But during that boom and extravaganza period, landlords are not just taking the raised rents and investing them in their buildings. They are going to their banks and saying, hey, my building is worth more. I can bring in new tenants who can pay more. So this building is far more valuable than it was when I bought it. So give me a, you know, let me take out the equity that I put into it and give me a bigger mortgage. They take out that equity and then they buy up a bunch more property. And that's that consolidation in the market we were talking about before. Buying and buying and buying, taking out more and more debt, having less equity in the buildings. And then when a crisis hits, like what we're in right now, they are in an extremely vulnerable position. So yes, we have a situation where tenants can't pay rent, therefore landlords can't pay mortgages, but they made themselves quite vulnerable to this. And I think that should affect how we think about the public policy response.
Now, landlords obviously make an awful lot of money during the booms, and especially these huge operators that you've been talking about. But there are people who get hurt both during the boom part of the cycle and during the bust part of the cycle. Can you talk about that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, tenants certainly don't do well in either situation. During the boom times, their rents are going up and they face displacement pressure. During the bust times, the landlords aren't necessarily investing in the buildings and they might suffer through the kind of crises of disinvestment. And no tenant wants to live in either situation. What they want is stability, a safe environment to live in and call home, that they know that they can be in into the future. Meanwhile, homeowners who are not looking to speculate, who are just looking to live in their home and have that security, may also face hard times in the boom times. So yes, the price or the value of their home has gone up due to no action that they took, but just the general market trends. So their property assessment will go up and their tax bill will go up. Meanwhile, their wages have not necessarily risen and they may feel that they have to sell just in order to stay on top of it all. And so you might see working class homeowners actually selling and moving out of gentrifying neighborhoods because they can no longer keep up with the expenses.
So we're obviously in the bust part of a cycle right now, but you know, there is hope that we're going to emerge from this pandemic, and a lot of economists are saying that the economy is poised to take off if in fact we do emerge. So do you anticipate that we're going to go right back into another one of the boom real estate cycles? And if so, is it too late to do anything about that? Is that inevitable?
I don't think anything is inevitable right now. I think this is a moment unfamiliar to us in many ways. Certainly a global pandemic on this scale hasn't been seen in 100 years. And I think we should always remember that the economy is political. That doesn't mean that the government controls the economy and can do with it what it wants, but it does mean that there are choices to be made about the direction that growth is going to go. And so I think we can see this moment as a great challenge, but also an opportunity to do things differently in the future. So we don't just reward those landlords who pulled equity out of rental buildings for years because it was a profitable thing to do. And instead we can think about what would be best for the tenants in that building and what can public policy do to maybe even get the buildings into their control or to get the buildings into the control of a nonprofit that will steward it in a responsible manner and not just sort of ride those boom and bust waves like a corporate landlord will. And it's important to remember in this situation, corporate landlords own every building as an individual corporation. They have a limited liability corporation that owns one building and another that owns another. And why this is relevant is that they can see, you know, one building fall into distress and potentially foreclosure, and it won't affect the rest of their holdings. So if we don't intervene, the large landlords are in a fairly good position to maybe lose a couple buildings here and there, but hold on to their main properties and continue making money. I think there are important ways we can intervene and do this housing system much better.
You, when we were talking before we came on the air, you mentioned that although we are in a crisis, clearly, that there are opportunities, that this is a time when we could begin to take some steps to make the real estate and housing situation in New York more equitable, more just. Can you talk a little bit about the opportunities that you see presenting themselves right now?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the first thing is to think about where is there open space, right? New York City is already a very dense city for the most part. There's not a ton of vacant land, but there is all of a sudden a lot of buildings, including in kind of prime central locations, where the old or current use does not make sense right now, and probably will not either come back fast enough to recoup the losses of this year, or might not come back at all. And so the prime examples of those are certain kinds of commercial office buildings where the tenants haven't been in for a year and may not be returning in full at all. And to an even greater extent, hotels. And it's worth remembering that in the history of New York City, some of the first apartment buildings were called hotels. And some of the older hotels that we have right now were at one point a sort of residential hotel.
Right.
It became a commercial hotel. We can move back to residential hotels in a way that does a lot to address the homeless crisis, and specifically the crisis of single adult homeless people, which is the fastest growing group. And if we don't do anything about this rent problem, we're going to see an eviction crisis and we're going to see a spike in homelessness. If instead we take advantage of the distress in the hotel market, take public dollars, buy out these hotels, and operate them as housing for currently homeless folks and low-income folks who aren't served by the current private housing stock, we can go a long way. Another thing to think about is the kind of buildings we've been talking about where the landlord pulled the equity out over the years, went into a lot of debt, now the tenants can't pay rent, so they're facing foreclosure. What do we do there? We argue that there's a lot to be learned from this city's history. We have in New York City already a pretty established system of what they call in Europe and Latin America, social housing, which is housing that's permanently affordable, deeply affordable, democratically controlled by the residents to some degree, and open to all, so not exclusionary. And most of that housing that we have that's sort of under those characteristics, publicly and nonprofit owned, came into that stock in a moment of crisis. So during the Great Depression, we started our public housing developments. In the 1970s crisis, we did in-rem transfers, HDFCs, and other kinds of permanently affordable housing. So we can do that again. But there's a few differences between now and then. First of all, the buildings remain overvalued. So it's expensive to buy them out right now because those property booms have brought them to, you know, inflated prices, and this crash happened real fast.
So right.
those prices are going to be high, but I think we can make the case that this is worth it in the long term. Another issue is that they're probably going to go into bank foreclosure before they go into tax foreclosure. And we got rid of our in-rem taking system a long time ago. And so there's not necessarily all the mechanisms we need to take public control of buildings that would otherwise go to the banks. So we need a few pieces of legislation to get in the way. One to think about.
You were talking about the historic situation when it came to real estate, and it was interesting that you mentioned how hotels used to actually serve as residences in many cases. And I remember reading about the old Brooklyn Dodgers, and a lot of the players on the team used to stay at a residential hotel in downtown Brooklyn. So there obviously was a time when the real estate market was more stable. I would leave it to you to tell me if it was more equitable and more just. But the question I have is, how did we get into this extreme boom and bust cycle? What set that off, and why has it remained so long?
That's a great question. And I think the answer is bigger than New York City. I think we can look at cities around the country that are experiencing similar real estate booms, and we can see it all over the world. And the simplest but biggest answer that I can give is that real estate has become the growth strategy for investment capital. And investment capital has moved out of a lot of other kind of traditional ways of making money that are less profitable than they used to, and moved into capital gains, the money that you make simply by owning something, where the rates of profit have gone up and the rates of taxation have gone down. So the value of real estate right now is something like $267 trillion.
Oh my goodness.
And that's 60% of the world's assets. And we've seen that at other times where like land is the predominant asset, but it's been agricultural land or land for production of other goods. This is a unique moment in history when urban housing is the way that most of the world's money makes more money. And so when we have so much money sunk into real estate, it becomes very hard for local governments to sort of take control of this very powerful system. And instead, a lot of local governments have sought to attract that real estate capital because that's the way that you bring in tax revenue. But we've gotten ourselves in a cycle where, yes, we have more and more real estate investment in New York, but we have a less and less affordable city. And we need to break that cycle and think about ways of having permanent affordable housing, or else we won't have a city at all.
One of the things that has puzzled me all along, and now I've got a housing expert right in front of me, so I have never understood why we have been unable in the United States to build affordable housing on a mass scale. We seem to be able to manufacture everything else from the, you know, the ballpoint pens that I use to automobiles to whatever. I've been reading about prefabricated housing, it seems like, for decades. I don't know if that's feasible anymore, but it seems to me that there must be a way to manufacture housing that is affordable. And it's such a crucial need. Mm-hmm. What has stopped us from doing that?
Great question. I think there is a piece of the puzzle that has to do with the building itself. And that's, I think, where prefabricated housing can lower the cost. And there are developments like this. Parts of the Atlantic Yards project in Brooklyn was built prefabricated, which was a big problem for the city's building trades unions who, you know, wanted to build it on site. Right. And instead, a lot of it was built offsite in a factory in New Jersey. That can bring down the construction costs. But it's the land costs that really drive the cost of housing production much more than it is. And it's a spatial question too. So, you know, the difference between housing and, you know, the ballpoint pen is, while the ballpoint pen can be manufactured in one place and then used in another,
right?
Housing has to go somewhere. And, you know, we have less and less vacant and available space in a city like New York, which means we might have to get rid of one thing to build another. And the history of building public housing in New York and many other places is, you know, a little bit checkered in terms of who is displaced to build the housing and did those people have access to get back into it. But we don't want to repeat those mistakes when we build new public and new social housing. We want to think about what open space is available, what are the obstacles to getting it, whether that's local opposition from, you know, wealthy homeowners who don't want affordable housing in their area, whether that's a sort of real estate driven political class that doesn't see affordable housing as a benefit, but instead sees it as a cost, and what can be done about that.
So in our closing moments here, I want to talk about you a little bit. You've got a PhD in geography, I think it is, from our graduate center at CUNY right here. This program is tied in with that. And you've also got a master's in urban planning from Hunter College, also a city university school. But what was it that drew you to housing and urban planning as a career? How'd you end up in that space?
Yeah, and I'm a proud son of CUNY, so happy to be on CUNY. Well, like a lot of people, a personal housing crisis is what drew me into housing struggles. I was working initially in the labor movement as a researcher for SEIU 32BJ, the Building Service.
Very familiar with it, covered it for many moons.
Powerful, important union.
Yeah.
And, you know, mixed into the housing system, but I was kind of radicalized around labor issues. Also, my father is a union member, and That was very important to me. When I graduated from college, I wanted to get into the labor movement. Meanwhile, though, I got evicted from a rent-stabilized apartment because I was not, I was subletting from the person who had the lease, right? And we didn't tell the landlord, and that's not allowed. But why didn't we tell the landlord? Because he was in jail for attempted murder of the downstairs neighbor and
good reason
of the building.
Right? Excellent so reason. Oh
we
my
were
God.
Just going to keep paying the rent. But he hired a private investigator and he found out. And so I was evicted from my home. Meanwhile, the guy who literally tried to destroy the housing in order to get the tenants out held on to it. And that sort of tipped me off that even in this city, which has some of the strongest rent protections in the country, there's a deep and fundamental inequity between the owners of property and the renters.
Well, it's such an important issue. So we're glad to see you on the case. This has been a really interesting story. Dr. Samuel Stein, thank you so much.
Thanks so much, Bob. It's great to be here.
And to our viewers, thank you for watching and see you next time.